Join Shobhit University.
As a young citizen of India, armed with technology, knowledge, and love for my nation, with a vision of transforming India into a developed nation, I'm joining Shobhit University. What about you?
Should I start, sir?
Please start.
Okay. A very good afternoon to all of you. I, Ritu Sharma, Assistant Professor, School of Liberal Arts and Languages, welcome you all in today's session. As you all know, that School of Liberal Arts and Languages is organizing a webinar on an upcoming science, technology and innovation policy implication on higher education and research. It's my pleasure to open this session about the topic of today's. Our government is promoting higher education's adoption of new technologies, the rapid advance of globalization that is lowering international barriers and transforming the business world is also expanding. The potential reach of colleges and universities with sophisticated communication technologies, institutions of higher education are no longer limited to student markets or educational resources in their geographic regions. Now, firstly, I would like to request respected registrar Dr. Mahipal Singh sir to share valuable words with us. Over to you, sir. Sir, unmute your mic, please.
Thank you, Ritu. Respected Dr. S.K. Vasne sir, Dr. Gunjan Agarwal, Dean School of Liberal Arts, and all the participants. First of all, I will congratulate Department of Liberal Arts and for choosing this such important topic. मैं सबसे पहले सर को थैंक्स दे देता हूँ. इट इज़ ए वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एंड आई विल से दैट द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ एनी एरिया एनी कंट्री डिपेंड्स ऑन टू थिंग्स ओनली, आइदर द नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज और साइंस और टेक्नोलॉजी. एंड इफ यू डिस्कस अबाउट दिस टॉपिक और अबाउट दिस थिंग, इफ यू टॉक अबाउट द गल्फ कंट्री, दे हैव द नेचुरल रिसोर्सेज एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस डीजल पेट्रोल एंड पेट्रोलियम्स they have developed. And if you talk about the other Western country, either it is Japan or it is India, that Britain or France, Germany, because of science and technology, they have developed. So this is a very important topic. And tomorrow, science and technology only can fulfill our requirements. So we are very hopeful, and मैं निश्चित रूप से कहूँगा कि वासने सर इस टॉपिक के बारे में मोटिवेट करेंगे, इस तरह की मतलब जो हमें एडवाइस देंगे, सजेशंस देंगे, एंड दैट विल बी हेल्पफुल टू ऑल ऑफ अस. सर थैंक यू मैडम.
थैंक यू. नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट डीन स्कूल ऑफ लिबरल आर्ट्स एंड लैंग्वेजेस डॉक्टर गुंजन अग्रवाल मैम टू वेलकम रिस्पेक्टेड स्पीकर एंड पार्टिसिपेंट्स. ओवर टू यू मैम.
थैंक यू रितु. थैंक यू वेरी मच. So a very good afternoon to you all. On behalf of the School of Liberal Arts and Languages, I welcome our respected speaker of the session, Dr. S.K. Vasne ji, participants and organizing team. An idea of education connects a person with civilized society. Our family, society, country, and the whole universe teach us in some or the other manner. But when we mention formal education, so one has to take care of employability and skills of a person. And professional education must involve critical and interdisciplinary thinking, discussion, debate, research, and innovation. Shouldn't take place in the isolation of one's speciality. New education policy connects science, technology, and innovation with other different areas of learning and research. Technical education should be offered within multidisciplinary programs, and India should take the lead in preparing professionals in cutting-edge areas, for example, artificial intelligence, big data analysis, machine learning, besides biotechnology, nanotechnology, neuroscience, with important applications to health, environment, and sustainable living for enhancing the employability of the youth. Now, today's session, the topic is well chosen, the role of science, technology and innovation, especially upcoming science, upcoming technology and upcoming innovation and implementation of all these things in higher education and research. So I believe the session will be highly fruitful. Now it is time to introduce our worthy respected speaker, sir, Dr. S.K. Varshini ji. He is advisor and head, International Corporation, Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. Dr. Sanjeev Kumar Varshini ji is a scientific officer with Government of India, Government of India, working with Ministry or Department of Science and Technology, Government of India since 1990, facilitating International Scientific Cooperation of India from the Department of Science and Technology with its bilateral and multilateral and regional scientific partners. He is Indian co-chair, governing body, Indo-German Science and Technology Center, and Indo-US Endowment Fund, member, board of directors of a private limited company, Global Innovation and Technology Alliance, and is member governing councils of the US, India Education Foundation, and International Advanced Research Center of Power Metallurgy. He is Indian Sherpa for Carnegie Group of Science and Technology Ministers, Indian focal point for BRICS Working Group on Science and Technology and OECD Committee on Science and Technology Policy. He is member Board of Research Studies in Department of Geology, Aligarh. April 2008 to June 2011. He has been contributing to promotion of international scientific cooperation as well as scientific industrial cooperation. He completed his master's in geology in 1984 from Aligarh Muslim University with university medal for obtaining first position. He qualified UGC NET in 1985 for junior research fellowship and lecturership. He pursued research at University of Delhi during 1985 to 1990 on Himalayan river systems, sedimentation, diagenetic and tectonic modifications. He was also awarded Dr. D.L. Wadia Research Fellowship in 1986 for his research on Himalayan geology. He is Life Fellow of Geological Society of India, Bangalore, Nepal Geological Society, Kathmandu, and member of International Association of Sedimentologists, Oxford. He also has numerous certifications to his credit. He also taught at Kurukshetra University in 1990. He has written several articles on science policies focusing on international scientific cooperation. He is also involved in science popularization, for which he writes in newspapers and magazines. So this is something about our worthy speaker. I request Varshini sir, please share your scholarly observation with us. Over to you, sir. I welcome you, sir. Please, sir.
Thank you. Namaskar to everyone.
Namaskar.
Dr. Mahipal ji, Dr. Gunjan ji, Ritu Sharma ji, and all other participants who are here today. It's my privilege to be part of this discussions. And today, I'm going to speak on upcoming science, technology, and innovation policy and how it is going to have its implication on higher education. Gunjanji has already set up the tone. She talked about various subjects. Today, science and technology is trying to address. Mahipalji conceptualized the basic framework how countries across could progress depending upon the resources or depending upon utilization of their talents. What I'm going to tell you is that science, technology, and innovation are not very far from higher education. And they are in a way connected, interconnected. And recently we adopted new national education policy, And that has thrown a lot of lights on how our future education is going to be. And this upcoming draft policy on science, technology, and innovation is also a step forward. We are about to adopt this policy sometime this year. So we are right now in the discussion mode. Just to give you a contextual background, you know, when this is going to be the fifth policy, so far we have come with four policy. The first policy, when we developed, you remember the word of our first prime minister who said that scientific institutions are the temples of modern India. And that is what the first science policy focused, to promote and sustain cultivation of science and scientific research. So that was the basic need, basic concept, basic idea. And it took another 25 years that to realize that it's not only the scientific knowledge or scientific temper, but what we gain out of scientific research, what comes out, and if we could convert that knowledge into useful products, then we could talk about technology component. So science policy came in 58, and then realization that utilization of new knowledge and conversion it into product, the technological competence came in 1983. And that was the first time when we talked about self-reliance. And then in 2003, we took another step forward, that science and technology should be connected with the society. So we were talking that whatever science we are doing, unless it is connected to the society, it may not be of much use. And that was the first time we talked about promotion of innovation system. So we adopted this policy in 2003. And then 2013, the last policy which we came up was talking about faster, sustainable, and inclusive development. Now, when we are talking about inclusive development, it essentially means that we are talking that how science technology is going to contribute to our everyday life. As far as current policy is concerned, which is under consideration right now, and I'm so happy to share that entire thing came during the COVID period. So we started this exercise somewhere in April last year, and very massive exercise we did. And we are so proud that it is bottom-up approach we have used. We are decentralized in our formulations, expert-driven, and then, of course, evidence we took care of. There were four tracks. First track was, of course, seeking public suggestions. So when we started it, kept it open for the public, that how this new science policy should look like, a lot of suggestions came, which were considered by the thematic group. Thematic group is devoted to a theme. For example, are we working on energy crisis? Are we working on water crisis? Not crisis. Are we working on energy security? Are we working on water security? Are we working on food security, health security? So different thematic tracks were made. And we put together experts from different parts of the country in a given discipline to look at the suggestions which we received from track one or from the public. Subsequently, as you might see that in our country, there are several stakeholders, which includes not only central government, but also state government. And within central government, there are a number of departments dealing with science. And then there are departments, for example, Department of Textiles, Department of Petroleum and Natural Gas, Department of Coal, which have subjects with an interest in scientific research, but they are not participating in the process of scientific research. So there are some departments which are participating, like Ministry of Electronics, Ministry of Space, Atomic Energy. But on the other hand, departments like Renewable Energy, Forest and Climate Change, they are not, they want scientific research to be happening in that area, but then they are not contributing to it. Similarly, state governments are playing very minimal role. For example, UP has a state S&T council, but how much project it is supporting, what are the activity? So we would like that we take all those ministries in the central government and science department of state governments into confidence. So that was the track three. And then we had this multi-stakeholder consultations, which is a cross cut. So what we had in track two, a thematic group consultation, here it was as per the themes, but when we reach here, it is multi-stakeholder, which means that this group has mixture of group, this suggestions, participant of track two and participant of track three. And if you see whom we did consulted, I think we try to cover every possible group, be it research student, young scientists, state government, various ministries, vice chancellors and ambassadors of universities, Vigyan Bharati, women scientists from different parts of the country, state government, industry captains, thought leaders, civil societies, northeastern region. These were the special thing we took care, northeast region, tribal regions, knowledge institutions. And then for the first time, we consulted member of Indian diaspora and embassy. This was never happening earlier, but we did it first time. Then we had 21 thematic groups in conversation with series across the table. So several things we did. And if you see our highest, this consultation exercise, all things happened during the COVID period when most of us were at home during the lockdown. But despite that, we did nearly 300 consultations in 6 months on an average 2 meetings every day. And it involved participation of 43,000 stakeholders. We received 100,000 suggestions. And this is the first ever policy where we have involved Indian states and diaspora in pre-draft consultation process. This is a very well distributed participation in terms of gender, education, economic state, and region. And gender balance we maintained throughout, and during all editorial and drafting exercise, at least 40% participants were women, and they developed both in policy input as well as drafting. Also, we had a good mix of young and old. So youngest member was 25-year-old, oldest was 80-year-old. In the survey, even 10-year-old participated and the 85-year-old participated. So this is just to give you a broad highlight, how did we did. The entire policy into 11 chapters. So I'll discuss these chapters one by one. So first is open science. I think this is going to be a game changer. So what we are proposing that if we could establish a national science, technology and innovation observatory, which will be repository for all kind of data generated from our ecosystem. And what we will do is that this will provide access to any public funded research. Now, when we are talking about research, of course it comes as a science policy, but its implication would be much wider. Because once government accepts this thing, then any data which is generated with the support of public funds would be available to everyone. So this includes published manuscript, don't treat only manuscript, published manuscript, research data, supplementary information, protocols. So all these things we are going to make public. So there would be a policy on open data policy, and we are providing access. And one major difference, what you are might be facing, that we have not written it, but primarily we are talking about right to knowledge, right to published information. So what is happening in the bigger institutions, for example, AIIMS, IIT, IIM, they subscribe n number of journals. Whereas a smaller place, including like yours, would be subscribing a limited number of journals. And it is because of high price of the journal. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to negotiate with publishers like Springer, like Elsevier, that if we could go one nation and one subscription policy, which means that anybody, whether he comes from Shobhit University, whether it comes from IIT, whether it comes from Gorakhpur University or Banaras University, everybody will have right to read what is already published. So this is something which we are trying to talk, and I'm sure that both these concepts, one nation, one subscription, and this data observatory and sharing of information would have nationwide impact on all the subjects besides, including and besides science and technology. The second chapter we are talking about is capacity development. And here what we are trying to do, you must have read this term HEI, Higher Education Institution in National Education Policy. So what we are trying to do is that, like National Education Policy, we are looking for holistic, dynamic, and responsive research base across in full academic spectrum within our HEIs. So this is what we are trying. And then we are trying to create engaged university, which would be talking about interdisciplinary projects. We are trying that our HEIs becomes innovation and entrepreneurship centers, which could promote at regional level collaborative approach between various stakeholders, which include academic and research institute, industry, small and medium enterprises, and startup. So this would be trying to put together that your center, which is a university, could act as a catalyst, as a center, and all these things like industry, SMEs, and startup could be working together. And then we are talking about upskilling of faculty members, so which is very much required. We would not like that our faculty remains constant at his learning level since what time he or she qualified the last examination. So there is a requirement of a regular teaching learning center, both in urban and rural areas, to enhance their experience and engagements for effective outcomes. We are trying to set up these collaborative research centers with the mix of SMEs, startup, R&D institution, and HEIs, where HEI has to play the central key role. We are also looking if the research institutions which we have established so far could be converted into research universities. And that would provide us a better utilization of the institutions in pursuing the research. We are also trying to create some independent and professionally managed self-sustaining equipment infrastructure. Now, what does it mean? That several institutions cannot afford all the equipment. So their students, their faculty, and also startup and small and medium enterprise, they need access to those equipment. So what we are trying through this exercise, that we are proposing to establish this center, which will help us in setting up such a facility where we could conduct, utilize any of the equipment. So first we were talking about right to publish knowledge. Here we are talking right to utilize any equipment which a researcher is looking for, irrespective of the background, whether he or she is a research student, faculty, or startup, or an industry. So such centers we are proposing to establish across the country. The third chapter is financing. So what we are proposing is that, as I said in the beginning, that several government departments having subjects worth research interest, for example, textile, for example, energy. So they should contribute minimum percentage of their budget to research activities. And that we are requesting not only from federal government, but also from the state government and PSUs, and also from private sector. So that in addition to the CSR, there should be a earmarked budget for science and technology. And each state Similarly, they should also do it. And for this foreign multinational company, when they are developing the new tie-ups, especially with our private sectors, with our higher education institution or research organization, they need to align their project on Indian needs and Indian priorities. And what we are trying to do is that to the private sectors, we are going to offer several tax incentives, tax credit, tax holidays. So several things we are planning, how we could attract them to invest in research. Similarly, on the other hand, we are also trying to provide them financial support. If they are picking up outcomes of research which have been developed in our higher educational institution. So for this, government will provide them seed grants, loan, research subsidy, equity, IPR credits, and open innovation system. And then we are proposing in this policy to develop a bank. So there is already, we have example, for example, NABARD, for example, IDBI. So similarly, we are trying to propose a STI development bank to facilitate long-term investment in strategic areas. And then we are also proposing some minor modification in GFR so that ease of doing research could be facilitated. The next chapter is on research. We are proposing joint appointment across government, which means that in government, especially in science and technology departments, there would be appointments which are coming from direct government or laterally from academia and industry. And when they are coming laterally from academia and industry, they would be coming for a specified period of 2 or 3 years, 5 years, a pre-identified period. And what we are trying to do is we are trying to make use of their experience, because when they come from academia, when they come from industry, they would be bringing in new experiences, new approaches, and that is what we are trying. And then one of the focus area we are trying is that whatever research we are doing should be good for different region of this country, different socioeconomic strata of this country, and especially should be talking about rural problems. And then public funding research is largely invisible. So we are trying to bring out more and more how different participation could come and research could be reoriented across. So to do ease of doing research, what we are trying to use a lot of digital platforms, e-governance model, so that you could do it at the click of your mouse. And we are creating several online platforms to implement open data and open access policy. So this would help in getting the knowledge across. And then we are creating new benchmark for ease of doing research so that research activity could be adequately funded and they are less bureaucratic, and accountability is in both direction of funding agency as well as of the researcher. The next chapter is on innovation and entrepreneurship. Here, the idea is that each educational institution should become an epicenter for promoting integrated technological knowledge system. So we have got a lot of traditional knowledge, which needs to be documented, validated, and taken into IP route. Now, this work has not been done. There are several solutions which a family knows, and they are passing it generation after generation, but they are not publishing it. They are not protecting it. And you might know that several, like turmeric treatment was taken by US for IP, which we had to fight tooth and nail. But how can we protect it? So what we are trying to do is we are trying to create an avenue for collaboration between innovators and scientists so that these things could be done. And then grassroots innovators would be supported for registration, that is documentation, claiming the IP, that is after documentation validation, and after validation, IP, filing of patent and legal claim. And then what we are looking for, creation of virtual incubators and accelerators in different part of country. I'm so happy to tell you that my department, Department of Science and Technology, has created nearly 200 incubators in the last 3 years across the country, across the discipline that we are trying. The next chapter is on technology development and indigenization. So what we are trying to do here is we are focusing a lot on indigenous development of technology so that whatever is required by Indian industry or Indian market or Indian society, if it could be developed in India, and if we have a comparatively better technology abroad, still we should prefer our own technology. That is how we can create more confidence of academia into the industry. Similarly, whatever key products are being imported by Indian company, we would like them to be created in India, to be produced in India. And what we are trying that to strengthen these capabilities, infrastructure would be set up, existing mechanism would be strengthened to adapt existing technologies. And we are looking for a policy push for development and deployment of sustainable technology to address major socioeconomic challenges and changing aspiration of the people. And again, what we are trying to do is we are trying to create a board. Now this board will help us to have a very long-term vision, say how a technology should look like after 40 years, 50 years. So normally researchers, when they are doing, they are more interested to do 2 year, 3 year projects, but this board would be working out a long-term vision and would be seeing that what we could produce in India without minor modifications. And for this purpose, they would be involving private sector, academic institutions, and would be making this self-reliant India. And we, for this purpose, we'll also set up a board. This board would be managed by independent body. And idea would be that this board would be encouraging private sector and HEIs to develop strategic technology which are needed for use in India. And then there are several dual use technology which are being used by several defense purposes. Now, if those technology could be made use for the civilian purposes, so this board will take such decisions that if these technology are suitable for transfer with the appropriate industries, then such clearances would be given by this board. The next chapter is on equity and inclusion. This is very interesting. And what we are talking about this is that science and technology should not remain only an urban language. And we should have each participation from each and every area. We should promote rural area, remote areas. We should promote and provide opportunity for women. Now here, what I must tell you that although there are women in our institution, in a good number, they are coming up, but they are not reaching the highest pinnacle. So they are not coming into leadership position. For example, we have got now 23 IIT, not a single woman director. We have got AIIMS across in various states, not a single woman director. We have got NIT in each state, but only one NIT has got woman director. What I'm trying to tell you is that women are coming, but somewhere on the path of career, they go out and there are very limited avenue for their comeback. And they are not reaching the leadership position. So this is what we would like to increase. We would like to promote talented women scientists into leadership position. We are also talking about LGBTQ, and we would like to include them into the mainstream. We are also talking about differently abled individuals, the Vyangjan, and they should be given special attention. And we would be talking how we could make structural and cultural changes to support such groups. And then what we are trying to do is we are talking about some special provisions. For example, ages related issues like minimization of career breaks for effective retention of trained women in science and technology. So what we are trying to say is if we could consider their academic age rather than biological or physical age, which means that in case they have gone out of their academic profile for a certain period of years, that period should not be counted. For example, if you are recruiting a professor and age is, let us assume, 45 years, and a lady with 50 years comes with 10-year career break, then why she should not be considered? Because her academic active profile is of that age. We are also recommending dual recruitment so that couples do not face challenge of that who will work and who will not work. So that's a challenge in case they are posted in different cities. And we are talking about mechanisms to bring out diversity, equality, and inclusion to remove barriers in participation, promotion, incentivization, retention, and effective engagement of the excluded group and marginalized communities. Now, this is where we are putting a lot of focus. The next chapter is communication. You know, science is something about which many few people know, because language of scientists, the researcher, is not language of the common man. And that is why taxpayers do not appreciate what are they doing through their research. So at least people in Department of Liberal Arts are a little happier, because their people can directly appreciate their work. But people, if they ask that what are your faculty doing in science and engineering, probably they may not have any idea. So what we are trying to do is that if we are trying to create a cross-disciplinary platform of communication, which will help to promote dialogues and knowledge transfer between researchers, science communication, and public. We are also asking scientists if they could develop community-centric program, regional science centers to promote science communication in local language, not in English, but in local language. And we are also talking about publicly accessible, constantly updated, and searchable databases. So this would make science communication much easier and much faster. And what we are thinking that in the, like corporate social responsibility, if we could have a national policy on scientific social responsibility, that will be motivationally incentivized to engage in communication. And we'll create SSR fund for this purpose. And we are also suggesting that each university, each institution, which is public funded, should have a dedicated wing for communication and public engagement. So that public knows that, okay, if there is a university, how it is contributing besides giving degree. Degree giving is one aspect, but a lot of knowledge is generated in the university. How it could be effectively used by the citizen of neighborhood area. So we are also planning that if we could have science media center at national and regional level, which could brief on their respective subjects after a particular time. And then this is one of the chapter on international engagement, and I am one of the co-author of this part of the science policy, where we have written that how we are not talking about brain drain, but we are talking about brain gain and brain circulations. So how to make best use of our diaspora in time to come, that is what we, is our main purpose. For this, we are proposing to establish certain fellowship and internship, which will provide them an opportunity to work in India so that we could make good use of their expertise. And for this purpose, we are creating a portal called Prabhas, which is Prabhasi Bharti Academic and Scientific Sampark. And this portal has been put in 18 verticals, and our member of the diaspora who are willing to work in India can get registered on this portal. And this portal also has all scientific institutions. I would encourage even Shobhit University should register on this portal and see what are the they can offer to the international community, at least our diaspora, if they have any interest to work in your university. And then we are also looking for science and technology for diplomacy and diplomacy for science. Now, what does it mean is, you see, today, many countries, for example, we are living in COVID age. And here we are using vaccine as a tool for diplomacy. So India has already supplied COVID vaccine to 45 countries, and we are willing to do it to many more countries. So this is what science and technology can do for diplomacy. But on the other hand, what diplomacy can do for science is something like our nuclear fuel. So you remember our 1-2-3 agreements. So we were denied nuclear fuels by several countries, but this, by our diplomatic efforts, we could bring back those arrangements. And today, several members of the nuclear supply group are providing us stuff of nuclear fuel. So what we are trying that it should be a both way bridge between science and technology for diplomacy and diplomacy for science and technology. We are also proposing to create international knowledge center, which would be virtual, and primarily working on exchange of talent and knowledge. And we would be creating opportunities like fellowship, joint research, and invite lectures. And then we have position of science counselors in our embassies, which we propose to increase. The next chapter is on governance. And as we said earlier, that we would be building up several digital platforms so that there is a synergy and coordination between various ministries to strengthen ecosystem. We would create this interlinked central state, interstate governance mechanism so that between the union government and state government also, we could have a better dialogue. What you might have read in the national education policy also, government is thinking to improvise research and innovation framework. And for this purpose, National Research Foundation would be created. And a standardized benchmarks, which would be international for research and innovation excellence would be developed. Metrics would be developed to evaluate and recognize the outcome of research activities and how relevant they are to Indian needs. And this I have already said that we would be recruiting 25% of professional and experts in scientific ministries, and capacity building would be done for research and infrastructure would be done by establishment of capacity building authority, which will help in planning, designing, implementing, and monitoring at national and state levels. So next and last chapter is the institutional mechanism. So we are planning to set up an institute, Science, Technology, and Innovation Policy Institute, which would be mandated to serve all aspects of its governance. There would be interoperable metadata architecture, which would be maintained by this institute. We would be strengthening this policy research so that we could identify gaps and provide evidence for effective policy making. We would be strengthening the science advice mechanism that would be strengthened at national and international level by several bodies like Cabinet Committee on Science and Technology Innovation, Interstate Committee on Science and Technology Cooperation, similar bodies. Overall, if I could sum up, this policy is looking to put India as a self-reliant and one of the top three scientific superpowers. I must say here that right now, India is number three in terms of scientific publication in the world after China and US. And we would like to convert that platform that not only we are publishing scientific papers, but those scientific papers provide India a place in the top three scientific superpowers. And that time we have taken is nearly a decade for that purpose. We are also planning to attract, nurture, strengthen, and retain critical human through people-centric science. Now, this is what we are saying, that we should promote people-centric science. And we are planning to double our full-time equivalent researchers, gross domestic expenditure on research, and private contribution to research every 5 years. So that is what we are looking at, doubling rate. And then we are trying to build both individual and institutional excellence in science, technology, and innovation with aspiration to achieve the highest level of global recognition and awards. Now, if you see our top mandate and our this bottom mandate, then they are interlinked. So we could be superpower only when we achieve this highest level of global recognition awards. Thank you. I would be too happy to take any questions or observation from you or your audience. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for grace the session with your valuable views. Now I would like to take the questions from the participants. The question number one is, sir, what role would be played by universities in ideating and monetizing research outcomes?
No, it depends on university, how do they would like to play the role. But what government is expecting, that university becomes a place to catalyze this idea, and whatever new research thoughts are coming. Now, it could be new research thought could be in terms of production of new knowledge, or it could be to work on an idea. If it is on a to promote new knowledge, then of course a research proposal has to be formulated and submitted to a funding agency, and they will come up with the support on competitive research grant basis. If the idea is that a student would like to try by themselves, so we would like university to play a role of a catalyzer and provide entrepreneurship opportunities. So for that, government has come up, already there are programs like Nidhi Priyas. Nidhi is national initiative on development and harnessing of innovation. And Nidhi Priyas is a first step towards, which is given to the students with a seed grant of about 10 lakhs to try out their idea if it is commercially viable. So not only they have to stand up on the technology, so that should be proven and market ready, but they have to compete in the market with the existing player. For example, today there is COVID vaccine. So many of us have already taken the vaccine, and now new vaccines are coming. So there are shingle shot vaccine, there are nasal vaccine which are coming up. So any new player which is coming to the market has to prove over the existing player why the new product should be absorbed by the market. So that goes good for the new products in any category. And I encourage your students to do both. If they want to do research and generate new knowledge, welcome. If they would like to try out their idea, again, there are. So both ways, government support scheme would be available. University has to provide them a place where they could get connected with funding agency and to the market users, agency, industry.
Yes. My second question is, sir, what initiatives being taken by the government to have an ongoing use utility of AI and big data analytics in STI and R&D, research and development?
Well, there's a huge program on what we call a cyber physical system, which is connecting machine-based information to the physical system. So for example, a lot of health analysis is now being done online based on big data and artificial intelligence. We would like to use maintenance of our critical infrastructure like electricity grid, transport system, etc., using this thing. So already this is being done. For example, your railway booking. Now, when you are doing a railway booking, so first fellow who books gets a seat in the central compartment. Second fellow who books gets in the first compartment. Third fellow who books gets in the last compartment. And then the intermediary bogies are booked. So this is already based on principle of artificial intelligence, how load can be distributed. Okay, so yes. AI is already in use, but more effective use it would be made. And government has launched a major program on what we call cyber physical system. And 25 technology hubs have been created across the country. And I would urge your researchers to Google out AI technology hubs of India, and then you will get the list of 25 hubs. And they are quite thematic. Each hub is focusing on a particular aspect. For example, someone is working exclusively on robotics. Someone is working exclusively on AI applications, new applications. Mm-hmm. Someone is focusing only on gaming.
Okay,
so there are 25 hubs, and I would urge your fellows to Google out and make use of it. And if they would like to participate, they can write to them.
Yes. The third question is, sir, what role would be played by universities in the collaborative research ecosystem?
Well, universities are key because they are having constantly a pool of young generation. So each year you admit new students, and they provide and bring out the new thought process. And it is up to university management how to connect university to both R&D labs and to the industries. And if there is an incubation chamber, so of course, university has to act as a bridge between all these players.
Yes, yeah. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. It's a privilege to have you as an eminent speaker of this session, sir. Thank you so much. Ma'am, do you want to ask something?
I believe sir has explained everything in a very detailed, in a minute manner. Your presentation is so well structured, so I don't think so ki there's a scope for any other question. Even then, if I have some questions, then I will definitely send these questions to you, sir, through email. And if you permit me, if you allow.
Sure, certainly. I think any of you who have some query in mind, I would encourage them to visit our website. And still, if that query is not resolved, our website is very simple, www.dst.gov, which stands for government, and then IN for India. So www.dst.gov.in is our website. I recommend you to visit our website and ask what are the questions if you have something in mind. What are our programs, current programs, how are we doing, what are the different subject themes we are covering. And once still you have some question, go to the same website directory. My email is there, and you are most welcome to make a query. I'll try to answer it as early as possible.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Yeah, now I would like to request Dean Ma'am again for vote of thanks. Please, ma'am.
Thank you, Ritu. Thank you. Now it's a matter of great pleasure for me to acknowledge the contribution of one and all. So I'm thankful to Almighty God who has given us such platform. And it was an opportunity for me, a very big thing for me to listen to you. On behalf of entire family of Shobhit University, I would like to thank our respected speaker who has added something new by sharing his scholarly observation. Thank you very much, sir, for this highly profitable, thought-provoking and enlightening session. So your words are like a treasure of knowledge. And you have mentioned so many things. I have noted all the things. So I'm grateful to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, and respected Registrar, sir, for their encouragement and their support. And I'm thankful to all the participants, our organizing team, especially our technical team. Thank you, Akhileshji. And I pray to God that we would materialize the dream of making harmony between evocation and vocation in our life, to make it more, to make it happier and fruitful. And here I would like to quote a few lines written by Robert Frost, an American poet. He has written in one of his poems, "To Tramp in My Time," okay, "My object in living is to unite my avocation and my vocation, as my two eyes make one insight, where only where love and need are one, and the work is play for mortal stakes." With these words, thank you all. Thank you very much.
Namaskar, mera.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar, sir. Thank you. Jai.